All right, yep.
From the entertainment capital of the world, Las Vegas. Sports, entertainment brought to you in stilettos. Your host, Tanja Brennan.
Woo! Welcome to Vegas, Sports Girl, and happy Tuesday. Every Tuesday, I just wait for that jam. It gets me going. You know what I'm saying? It's a Tuesday afternoon at 4 p.m. and the weather's nice out. Hope you're having a great week so far. We are back for another fun hour. Lots of sports, lots of entertainment. We actually have a special guest in studio as well. Later in the hour, all I'm going to say is boxing. I'm excited about that. Anyhow, let me introduce to you. You know him. You love him. Joining us again, not in stilettos, Ron Futrell.
The band is back together again, man. The entire band is back together again. So glad to be here.
I know. We met. I missed you.
Well, I was sort of busy with this hockey thing that was going on for a while, and every Tuesday night was that. And yep. So I was my other job at Channel 8 sort of took precedent.
Sort of the big job, right?
Yes.
I know. Well, I'm glad you're back, Ron. I did miss you.
This is big here, so don't discount this.
Honey, I'm not discounting it.
Thank you.
Anyways, glad to have you. We've got a lot of sports to talk about. Obviously, this weekend, we had the big Kentucky Derby. That was pretty impressive. I wore my hat. Not.
Oh, yeah.
But I love those hats. They're pretty stylish. I need to get me one. I always said I need to get one with the big frills in red.
Oh, that would be no. That would look cool. Right. I mean, you would look great in them. You'd be the lady in red. Okay.
I'm trying to make it out there too.
Here's my thoughts on that, and something that hasn't been mentioned before. People are going back and forth on should I, man. I do have some thoughts on that, but this is good for the sport of horse racing, by the way, because we're talking about it here. People are talking about Good Morning America, talking about it, Today Show, CBS This Morning, an evening show. They're talking about horse racing, and that cannot be a bad thing. Even though it's controversial and all that sort of stuff, it's not going to have lasting damage to the sport if anybody thinks it's going to do that. But, and they're also talking about sports. I saw Jim Gray on Fox News yesterday talking about all the bad calls lately in sports and the effect they've had. Talked about the call in the national championship or the semifinal for the college basketball championship when Virginia should have been out of it because of a double dribble that wasn't called that was missed. They talked about the Rams-Saints game last year in the NFC championship game.
The Knights game
against San Jose and the call there and the apology by the NHL. And then this call in horse racing. So for horse racing to be lumped into the big boys, so to speak, is good. Overall, I think it's good for the sport that people are talking about it, even though it'd be a controversial decision and that sort of stuff. But still, hey, they're talking about it.
Hey, it's horses. I love horses, by the way.
Do you? 100%. I didn't know that. Are you a horse racing fan?
Well, I love horses. I said on my bucket list, one of these days I'm going to own a horse. And I don't know if you know this, but last July in Aspen, Colorado, I was on a horse. Beautiful ride. Came across a big black bear and my horse took off.
Oh.
And I could not control myself on the horse. He was a rodeo horse, Beauty, and fell off. And while he was still in full motion, his right back hoof took my ankle out. So
no,
I was in a boot. Oh, it was horrible.
No, I didn't.
I could not wear stilettos for at least 3 months. It was horrible. I'd wear flats. It was so ugly.
Okay, but you recovered well. I didn't see a limp or anything. So you come back from that. And well,
but I do love horses, so
it's better than the horse keeping you with the bear.
Yes,
okay.
I admire and respect those jockeys. I'll tell you what. So, in 145 years, something like this at the Kentucky Derby has never happened. That's insane.
Yeah, they did have a drug scandal in the '60s, mid '60s. It was a horse that tested positive. So even horses and drugs, okay?
Wow.
Tested positive for a banned substance. And was disqualified, and that happened weeks after the event once the drug test came back. But never have they had this happen at the Derby. It happens in smaller races and those sort of things. Happens not often, but it does happen there. And I don't know. I think there's a lot of issues. I think it was uncalled for. I didn't have a bet on the race either. It didn't matter. It didn't matter to me what direction it went. But I thought it was, first of all, the horse that was most affected by it, I think it was a horse win, or just win, something.
War of Will.
War
was
of Will,
the name
thank
of the
you.
Horse,
War of
yes.
Will was most affected by it, and they didn't complain about it. And the other horse on the outside, Country Home.
Country House.
Country,
Country House was the runner-up that ended
Country
up.
Pancakes, Country Breakfast, Country... Okay, 65-1 odds. That horse that finished second complained and was nowhere near, by the way, that the winning horse.
Mm-hmm.
And so anyway, I think they should have taken into account, which they apparently did not, but they should have taken into account the horses that were complaining and why they were complaining instead of... Because, the horse that got tapped did not complain,
mm-hmm.
was not the
mm-hmm.
one that issued the challenge. So they didn't feel they were wrong, and they were the one that hit, you know. And, yes, the horse left its lane because you're supposed to maintain and stay in your
sure.
lane. And it did do that. There's no question about that. But in a muddy track on a day when things were a little bit crazy, I also thought the jockey knew something was up because right after... He did an interview, and he talked about the horse being spooked by the crowd. Like he was trying to get out in front and make an excuse for
mm-hmm.
the horse going out of that lane.
Mm-hmm.
So the jockey knew that
something was up.
That
right.
something could happen,
right.
that there could be a challenge. And
there
anyway,
was a
that,
plan
be,
that,
that being said,
right.
not
interesting
bad for the sport.
Race.
Wrong decision, I believe, but I really don't. It's,
right,
don't
right.
care a whole heck of a lot. But
you got to talk about it. This is like really relevant. Maximum Security was the favorite, and he's out. And he doesn't race in the next race on May 18th.
That's called the Preakness.
They do have
it's sort of a big race coming up. And not having that horse in the Preakness, too, does not help that field. And so anyway, there you go. Oh, the legal action. They're filing legal. That's probably not going to go anywhere. I don't want the U.S. Supreme Court dealing with
sure.
horse racing.
Apparently, Ron, $6.2 million was put down on Maximum. That's insane.
And that would be just there at the track, I'm going to guess.
Right.
Because now if you're taking off-track betting,
then
that number is much
higher,
greater.
Right.
Much greater.
All right.
Yes, and everywhere else.
So I guess congrats to Country House. You know, I mean,
Country House, Country Bacon, Country Sausage. I'm getting hungry.
Yeah, me too. So let's talk hockey. This is, you know, last night was an incredible game. The San Jose Sharks and the Colorado Avalanche. I feel the Avalanche play with so much speed. They control that puck so well. San Jose is just aggressive. They're just, you know, they're ready to fight every 2 seconds. But what a game. Last night, in the last 2 minutes, San Jose decides they want to tie it up, and they tie it up. We go overtime. Colorado Avalanche comes out on the top. So now we're going to game 7 tomorrow night.
In San Jose.
That's going to be tough for Avalanche, but I'm not discounting them.
No, Nate McKinnon is one of the best in the league for Colorado and playing on the top line and everything he can do. They've got a very good number one line to the Colorado Avalanche. So we'll see. Anything. Oh, as we know, anything can happen in a game 7. And watch out. There might be.
It was.
There's going to be some makeup penalty calls in game 7 and do a 5-minute major on somebody for something. Joe Thornton for bad beard. 5 minutes. Major penalty.
Can he trim that beard? That is disturbing. Like, how do you eat soup? That is like ramen.
No, you don't. It's through a straw. And he's. First of all, good thing about Joe Thornton, he's 140 years old and he's still playing hockey.
Right.
I mean, you've got to like that. He's a grandpa of hockey, and he's contributing, doing well, and playing well. And now Joe Pavelski, the guy who got hit
mm-hmm.
in the penalty, and we don't need to go back on all this sort of stuff and explain it, but got hit in the penalty that hurt the Golden Knights in Game 7 against the Sharks. He came out this week and said, oh yeah, that was not a penalty. That should not even have been a penalty at all. It shouldn't have been a minor penalty.
Mm-hmm.
And, oh well, okay, everybody's on board. Okay, the refs say it sucked. The refs don't get to go any further in the playoffs. Oh, the Knights don't get to go any further in the playoffs. And, oh, by the way, Joe Pavelski said it wasn't a penalty, and here we go.
Speaking of refs, they're such great skaters. Do you know, are they former hockey players?
Many of them
are.
Are
they just, really?
Oh, yeah, many of them are.
I always wondered that, because I would not want their job.
Oh, no, it's not. Well, let's go here. There are four of them on the ice. Now, so watch. Two of them are linesmen, and they will stand at the blue line, and they will check for offsides mm-hmm. and icing and other things. They can make. They cannot call penalties, the linesmen. The two refs that have red armbands on, those referees, those officials, are the ones who call penalties. Either one of them
okay.
can. And so that's the way they're divided out there. But no other sport has more risk involved, and they'll get clipped every once in a while
yeah.
with
Imagine
a puck.
Ryan Reeves coming at you full
so,
force.
Whoops.
Ooh, I love his commercial, too, by the way. That's
oh, do you like
that.
The S&W, Southern Nevada Water Authority? Yeah, and it's... I like that you're seeing these guys involved in the community and doing these sort of things among
mm-hmm.
that one. And I did wonder the question, though, watering clock. No, as much as I like the commercial and think it's great, like, I don't need to be told to switch my water. By the way, my watering clock, I water on Sundays because I water every other day right now, and it might be every other week. I'm watering on Sunday, probably doing the illegal I'm an
You're
offender.
You're caught red-handed,
okay.
Ron.
I'm
admitting. Every other day?
I'm confessing. Right now, right now that's
okay.
what I have the clocks on. It gets pretty hot now. It's 90 degrees. And so anyway, it's... I get it in October. Okay, I get it in October to say, hey, turn your clock down, a reminder to don't water every day, twice a day, as you have to do in the middle of summer. But let's... tone that thing down, baby, and I don't mind that reminder, but why this time of year? Why now? Why?
We're Vegas. We're unique. Things happen differently in Vegas,
Save
apparently.
Save your money
I know.
Lowering water bills.
Well, speaking of water, going back to ice, congratulations to the Boston Bruins last night. They won.
Yeah, they did. I wanted
very happy about
I
that.
I wanted Columbus in
did
that
you?
Series. Yes, just because I like upsets right now, and that's what's happening in the NHL. My mom, when she was alive, she's from near Columbus, and I have a lot of relatives there. Go Ohio State, they would want me to say, and everything. So I would, I wanted Columbus to do something good there. But I'll tell you, who the Carolina Hurricanes, watch out for them in
yep.
the East, man. They are on a tear right now. Could they win it all? It's wide open this year.
I was just going to ask you, what
yeah.
are your thoughts? Who
yeah.
do you think is going to come out
Carolina's
there?
Carolina's coming out of the East. I think they
okay.
beat Boston. And who comes out of the West? San Jose. It's wide open for San Jose.
Goodness.
You know, as much as I know people don't want me to say that. But Dallas Stars tonight against St. Louis. Dallas has played well on the road. As long as their goalie is Bishop's in good shape. He took a shot, like a gunshot. A puck hit him in the shoulder. They went to smaller goalie pads this year to try to reduce scoring. And one of the thoughts was that I remember bringing this up early in the season with the goalkeepers and with Gerard Gallant in a news conference and said, you know, could guys be getting hit by pucks and get hurt? And everybody pretty much discounted it as probably not going to happen. But that's exactly what happened. The smaller pads, Bishop's a big guy, and it whacked him, and he went down like he had been
wow.
shot, and St. Louis scored a goal. And the game was tied at 1 at the time. And then it went on from there. They ended up winning 4-1, and he was hurt. He says he's 100% for tonight. We'll see. But I do like Dallas on the road in St. Louis to pull off the upset tonight.
Good games. I love watching this hockey series. We're going to go to break in a second. I just wanted to mention, speaking of upset, big soccer game, Barcelona gets beat by Liverpool today 4-0.
Right.
I'm following a little bit of soccer. Yeah.
Follow Manchester United.
Exactly. All right. Well, we got more after the break. Check us out on VegasSportsGirl.com and on social media. Like us, share us. And we'll be back in just a couple minutes.
Hey, this is Dan, the laptop man from PC Laptops.
It is crazy how quick these segments go.
Oh, yeah. You're still doing the 2 minutes, right? Every.
And you get Ron Gavin and taking up all the time.
No, I love it. Love it.
Our shows are interesting. I'm just being honest. I've run a gamut of different ones. And because either you have people that come with all kinds of stuff and they're like, wow, that was quick. Shoot.
Yeah.
And then you have people that are just like,
struggling.
Yeah, well, let's take another break and then, yeah.
Well,
it's
interesting.
It's tricky.
Like, I like to have more content. And
that's how
I can
believe.
Have guests. Oh, next Tuesday, I have the guy that does the whole NBA league. Jamal.
NBA Summer League?
Uh-huh.
Who is it that's coming in?
Is it Jamal? Jamal. He just called me last week.
Good.
He's coming on the show next Tuesday. So that's going to be good.
Yeah.
And I think John Lynch is going to call in because I want to talk to him about the draft with Bosa. I like having guests if I can.
Yeah.
Jazz it up a little bit. Okay, so we are going to talk a little NBA.
Okay, go there.
You're making me uncomfortable.
Perfect.
Perfect.
Just by looking at you.
Yeah.
Good.
Get a little nervous.
Good. You make me feel uncomfortable.
I know.
Just by looking.
I know. Just by looking.
About 30 seconds.
30. Okay. Not a lot of NFL news. Did anything major happen today?
No.
I've been following
the
NFL.
The facility's looking good out there. They're getting that thing.
I saw
the practice.
Yeah, the sign.
The signs on the main stadium. But the facility's got Henderson there. Those things are going up in a hurry.
All right.
There we go.
Your face is coming. I almost have smell your like.
You just let me know when you're ready.
Oh, no,
I love
this
song. Right?
Yeah.
All right, welcome to Vegas Sports Girl Round 2, Ron. Round 2.
Right.
Good music selection, all right. Good music.
Guns N' Roses.
Yes.
I try.
I like it. We got some NBA news. Big game last night with the Golden State Warriors and the Houston Rockets. Golden State Warriors were defeated last night, 112-108, despite Steph Curry, 30 points, 8 assists. And Harden is still doing well. He doesn't pass, but he's still making baskets.
Oh, he's lefty just shoots, man. And the bearded lefty, he just goes at it. And it's been interesting. The home team has won each of those games, and now it might go to a game 7 in Golden State, okay? And my money's got to be on the Warriors.
Mm-hmm.
And as much as... And I don't have a favorite anymore. The Lakers, let's see.
That's your team?
Yes.
Right?
Grew up a Lakers fan, so I will
yep.
always be a Lakers fan. Even though it's been real tough to watch the last 6 years, they have not made the playoffs. That being said, it was sort of fun to see the Clippers beat Golden State in a couple of games
mm-hmm.
this year. That was a little bit shocking to see that happen. I did not mind that being an L.A. guy. And we'll see where it goes from here, but whatever. I mean, Golden State's still the favorite. Milwaukee's coming out of the East. First of all.
Milwaukee looks pretty good.
No, the Greek Freak is bringing them out of the East.
The Greek Freak?
Yes.
Is that a new slogan?
No, he's had that for a while.
Really?
I mean...
Can you pronounce his
yes.
name? Because I sure can't.
Yes, that's the guy
that I had you pronounce. I could not see that.
The Greek Freak.
The Greek Freak.
His family, there was a great 60 Minutes piece on him, and his family's from Greece, and they were dirt poor. Originally from somewhere in Africa, and moved to Greece, and they were basically migrants. They were poor. They were family grew up with next no money and had to beg and the boys, him and his brother, at very very rough circumstances. They loved it there in Greece, but financially it was very difficult for them. And then got spotted by an NBA scout and. The rest is history.
Wow.
And he has great love, classy guy, the Greek Freak, Giannis. And he has great love for America and the opportunities it's giving him here for Greece and for his homeland. He's trilateral. Let's go there with his nations. And it's just a classy family, great guy. You can tell he was raised properly. And it's nice to see that. Can't help but root for the Greek Freak
right.
and Milwaukee because of that.
Can I just tell you, I love your storytelling.
Oh, sorry, do I go
I
on?
I love
to
it. No, because that's something, I learned something new today from you, Ron.
Yeah.
Thank you, very impressive.
Greek Freak, no reason to root for Milwaukee.
The Greek Freak. Speaking of Milwaukee, well, Boston leads the series 3-1, right?
No, they don't lead the series. Hold on a second.
Boston, well, I want to say they're leading the series right now 3-1.
Okay, I'll take your word for it.
But forgive me if I miss.
I have to look up stuff.
Anyhow.
It's 3-1.
3-1.
Boston?
So, yep.
Oh, no, Milwaukee.
Oh, I said Milwaukee. Did I say Boston?
Yeah, you said Boston.
Milwaukee.
Yeah, Milwaukee leads the series 3-1.
Retract. Milwaukee leads 3-1.
Yes.
So that's it's a great series. I tend to watch the West Coast series more just because I'm a West Coast girl. But, you know, I used to love that rival between the Boston Celtics and the L.A. Lakers back in the day with Magic and Larry Bird. That was one of the best series ever.
It was. The NBA would love to have that sort of a series back again. You know, it's not really going to... 2010, you had Boston, L.A., you know, that happened. Well, let's go Boston and L.A. I mean, it happened with in the Super Bowl. It happened in the World Series. Sad to say, the LA teams lost to both of those, you know. So, well, it's been nice to see that rivalry come back again. But LA's got to represent. LA's got to do some things, and not let Boston.
Team's got to do something.
Yeah,
you know. Speaking of when we talked about the James Harden not passing, he had 38 points last night. That was crazy. That was crazy.
Yeah, he's fun to watch, and I like him because I'm left-handed, so I have a propensity towards lefties.
Uh-huh.
So when I see that, I go, wow, you can flat-out shoot.
Anything can happen. I know Coach Kerr from the Warriors said, our guys look like volleyball players to their football players in the center. That was how he kind of...
Oh.
That was his
analogy. That's a pretty good comparison.
Yeah, pretty good comparison.
I'd say Draymond Green looks like a bit of a football player, though.
Yeah. Anyway, I like Coach Kerr. He's great. Other NBA news. Cavaliers are obviously looking for a new head coach. They're scheduled to interview Spurs assistant Ettore Messina. I don't think they did that interview yet. And Cousins, which still has the quad injury, looking forward to coming back hopefully soon.
Yeah, he'll be fine.
He'll be back. NFL news. Now, this is interesting. Jerry Jones made some comments today about quarterback Dak Prescott, you know, not knowing what they're doing with their contract. He made a statement this morning that said, I believe he's in for the long haul. It doesn't sound too promising, in my opinion. I believe that Dak is your long-term quarterback. You either know or you don't, right?
Yeah, it should be a little more convincing than that. And Dak has been an interesting guy.
Inconsistent, in my opinion.
Oh, no, he has been inconsistent. You're absolutely right with that. And then he can go out and just tear up a game and then disappear for the next one.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's difficult. I'm not sure whether he's a great pocket passer yet. I don't know that he will develop into one. They've made some changes there. Scott Linehan is no longer their offensive coordinator, and that's a change there certainly with Dallas. He used to coach here at UNLV for a year or two, I think, with John Robinson, and I knew him in high school, played up in Sunnyside. He was a Sunnyside Grizzly in Washington State when I did sports up there. Scott Linehan was, so I go way back with him on that. So, but at the same time, I got it. I mean, they have been pretty patient with him, I think, for a long time there in Dallas, and now they need some offense.
They need offense, and if Coach Garrett and his team doesn't step up to the plate, it's going to be interesting. My question is, how long do you hold on to a head coach when you don't have a winning season, you know? The other true question is what are they going to pay him? You know, you've got Kirk Cousins at the top making about $30 million. Jimmy G making about 29. Are they going to put Dak above that $30 million? I don't think he deserves it, in my opinion. I think he's a good player.
Oh, no,
he's just not that star factor. It's not the Drew Brees or, you know, in my opinion.
Right. Salary-wise, he is not a top five quarterback.
No, not at all.
But neither is Derek Carr, who with the Raiders is being paid a top five salary, but he's not worth that unless we see something different this year that we didn't see before, okay? And that's up to Gruden and the gang to see what they can do with the Raiders. But
speaking of Raiders, we talked about that stadium going up. I cannot believe how good it's looking. It's got the banner, the sign, the sponsors. Did you see that
on
the 15?
Yeah, I did see, yes.
Was that new? Because I just noticed it.
No, it is new. It's like brand spanking this week new. The Raiders got UNLV up there. That's the stadium that's just... south of on the south end of the strip.
Mm-hmm.
It's really not actually on the strip, unfortunately. It's on the other side of I-15 from the strip, near Mandalay Bay, and so you can't miss it going up there. And also their facility out in Henderson. Now that thing is popping up
now
too. They just add water, and now they got the scaffolding all going up and everything happening. That's all the framing, I should say, not scaffolding, framing for that practice facility. That's got to be done by this time next year. So that one is even it's easier to build that. It's not as complicated as the 65,000 seat stadium near the strip, but they yeah, they'll get that done in time, and the practice field and locker room and offices and that sort of stuff. That's out near the M on St. Rose Parkway.
Yeah.
You know that neighborhood.
I'm out in that neighborhood,
right?
Yes.
And I haven't seen it. I just saw pictures of it. So you've seen it live.
It's exciting. I just can't believe we've got an NFL team coming here. It's crazy.
No,
finally. Whether you're a Raiders fan or you're not, you've got NFL in Las Vegas. So,
yeah.
You know, speaking of Raiders.
I thought the NFL would be at the very bottom of the last to come here.
Mm-hmm.
Once Major League Professional Sports started coming, but I didn't take into account that the Raiders needed Vegas more really than the NFL needed Vegas, and they both worked together, but the Raiders needed Vegas, and
goes
so thus, boom, there
yeah.
you go, the NFL said, okay,
yeah.
let's
there
go.
You go.
Gambling? What gambling? Sports
exactly.
betting? What sports betting?
Speaking of Raiders, Richie Incognito met with the Raiders on Monday. And tomorrow night, the Raiders are holding their second annual Swing for Kids. It's their community charity event at Top Golf, where all the proceeds go back to communities and schools. Last year, proceeds went to veterans. Just a great initiative, and they're going to have a lot of Hall of Famers there. I know I spoke briefly to Tim Brown's peeps today. Tim will be there. Of course, you've got Michael Haynes. So it's always a great turnout. Looking forward to that.
And a good location there. I like Top Golf. It's fun stuff to do. Great food there. And just grab a club and hit a few shots
great
out there
food.
And try to hit one of them targets. Good luck.
Have you noticed how many football players always seek Vegas and say they're coming here to play golf? I mean, this is a destination for them. Anything golf related.
Oh, no.
It's crazy.
It's
football players love golf.
And you don't need another reason to come to Vegas, but... Wow, now there are plenty of reasons.
Yep. And also, Ron, XFL announces their season launching February of 2020.
Yeah, come on.
Did you see that
Vince
yesterday?
McMahon doing that? Yes, I did see that, and I shook my head and said,
what?
Okay, we're going to try this one again. He hate me. It was fun. 20 years ago when they were here in Vegas, they succeeded here in Vegas. I don't know if that speaks poorly for our city.
Is that because we had no NFL here, possibly?
No, it was... The league itself was a little bit cheap in that sense. The problem was not that Vegas support was probably the best franchise in the league. The problem was the league and the NBC contract and the stuff with that. The league folded. And so that being said, it worked. I went out to a few games at Sam Boyd Stadium and watched it and sort of even enjoyed it. While I laugh at it, I did enjoy it.
Mm-hmm.
And there are some things the NFL took from the XFL. One of them was the camera work, was to have this guy cam and the camera over the field to be able to do stuff. That the NFL hadn't done that before, and cameras out on the field, not during play, but at least to get a good shot,
good
better shot
right.
different angles, send a cameraman out there and do that sort of stuff. So some of the camera angles, some of the stuff they use were derived from the XFL. That being said, well, okay, let's do it. I mean, CBS tried the AAF or whatever that was called, AFL.
Alliance.
And it didn't even make it through the season. So we'll see. I mean, it's tough. I even watched some of the games, and it was sort of fun. But I don't know if we need more. I don't know. More football is not better football. Let's go there. More football is not necessarily better football. In fact, it's more football is probably worse football.
Right. Well, we've got all kinds of things to talk about, all kinds of sports to cover. We have a special guest coming up after the break, but we're going to have to take a break. So stay with us on Vegas Sports Girl.
I was just pointing, saying we were carrying them on the station.
Oh.
But, you know, for the couple weeks that it lasted.
Sorry. So I'll stand over here.
Here, you want to put them over
here?
Yeah,
I'll give you the mic.
I'll go over here to this.
Over here?
Yeah.
I'll stand right here, and they can sit, right? Can we do this?
Sorry, yeah. Yeah, that works. So you'll be on one, and I'll go up in here. Two, she's still on four. Oh.
for your vehicle, there are only two places that make it extremely convenient for you. Visit Busy Boots Automotive at Durango and Flamingo, or Zip Zap Auto at Durango and Cheyenne. They provide free diagnosis and free towing with repair.
Do you want
to have a
little extra time?
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Come on in.
Why don't I put you two here in these seats, if you don't mind? And if you two want to come in, you can. There's a chair back here. Awesome. Have a seat. This is Mr. Joe and Sylvia Cortez.
You know, anyone can get her on, but she's the executive director.
Yes, yes. What we can do. Yep.
If you want to just take that one. Okay. Do you want some headphones too?
Can you try?
Can you hear president?
No. Oh,
wonderful.
Sorry, Hunter.
Can
I grab this? How much time do we
have? I'm
going
to have to add a 30, so I can go grab a headphone. Sorry. No, that's not your fault. I realize we didn't have anything here.
No, no, we're not taking calls, are we?
No, yes.
Yeah, so
do you want a pair actually, or did you want headphones?
No, I don't need headphones.
Yeah.
All right. Well, if that's the case. All right, 30 seconds.
Can we share one?
How much time we got?
Yeah.
30 seconds.
No, how much time we got to talk?
I'm going to have you on for about 1.5 segments. If that's okay.
How much time is that?
About 15. We'll go. I'm going to come into the break, talk a little bit of sports, introduce you all. We'll talk a little bit of boxing, then we'll go into that.
Yep. Okay. All
Welcome back to Vegas Sports Girl, and we have a jam-packed show. We've got awesome special guests in studio right now. I'm Tanja, and it's Tanja time. Welcome again this week. Joining me, Ron Futrell. Ron, you know Tiger Woods was honored yesterday at the White House.
Oh, no, I do know that.
Did you see that?
No, and he's taking a lot of heat for it, unjustifiably, okay? President Trump wants to go ahead and give him and honor him with the Medal of Freedom. He deserves it, number one. And bless him for being that courageous to go ahead and take it, accept it, and do it when at a time when they might think politically it wouldn't be expedient. But they're good friends.
Yes.
Have a long history together. So bless him for that. And he deserves it. Well deserved it. And glad to see Trump did it. Glad to see he did it. And by the way, all the naysayers, just shut up.
Yeah.
How about the rest of you? No, how about that? Should I say it differently?
No.
Okay, just shut up.
We've had enough naysayers, I can tell you that right now, right, in the world of sports. Just a little bit of aviator news. They are home this week. They're home for a while now. So if you want to check out a fun night with the family, go buy your tickets to a baseball game. I spoke to Jim Gemma again this afternoon. He said, what a great turnout. They're very happy with the support of the Las Vegas fans. And Major League Baseball news. We've got all kinds of games going on. So, joining us, though, let's get to the real meat and potatoes of this show today. Joining us in studio, this is a special treat for us. Mr. Joe Cortez and his lovely wife, Sylvia, are joining us. Now, for those of you that don't know Mr. Cortez, Joe is a successful amateur boxer who turned pro at age 18, had a record of 10 wins and 1 defeat as a pro. In 1977, he started working as a referee, taking on major championship fights, including George Foreman, Mike Tyson, Evander Holyfield. And he's doing something really cool. Him and his wife are doing something very cool in this city, as well as the director. We're going to get there in a second. Renee Saminsky is in studio. But first, I want to ask Joe. Joe, thanks for joining us, by the way, on Vegas.
My pleasure.
I have to ask you about your boxing career. This is just so cool for me. What was your most memorable moment as a referee?
I'll tell you, there's been some great moments in boxing. 35 years as a referee, refereeing some of the greatest fights in the last 3.5 decades, was an honor for me. And sometimes I got to pinch myself when I see some of these Hall of Famers in front of me, like I did last Friday night. And they had a fundraiser for the World Boxing Council, the Hubla Watch. And we raised $1.2 million Friday night. And looking at all the champions that were called up on the stage, Looking at Julio Cesar Chavez, Oscar De La Hoya, George Foreman, Mike Tyson, Vander Holyfield, Jeff Fennec, Roberto Duran, Chidwell Leonard. Just name a few that were up there. I counted 11 of the 14 that were up there. 11 of them I was had the honor of refereeing throughout my career. Refereeing Mike Tyson 9 times. I mean, it was a lot. You know, Chavez 6 times, De La Hoya 6 times. And it just, Holyfield also about 3 or 4 times. It's just been an honor for me to be in such a sport that they call a brutal sport, but to me it's the most wonderful sport out there. You know, I hate to see fighters when they get knocked out, when they get hurt seriously. I kind of hate, don't like that part, but that's when you need a good referee to take control of a fight and make sure the fighters don't take unnecessary punishment. And I train referees around the world to make sure they do their job correctly. And to me, it's been a great honor refereeing for 35 years, close to 175 world championship fights. My dream was to do one world championship fight, and that was back in 1982, my first world title fight. It was Aaron Pryor against Miguel Montilla in Atlantic City. And when I retired in September 2012, the year, 1 year after I got inducted into the International Boxing Hall of Fame, I said, I think it's time for me to go out. I want to go out while I'm still on top.
That's awesome. That's awesome. And you have an amazing history. I read about your family, and it's just so cool that you're here in Las Vegas and doing such great things. I wanted to ask you, too, you actually recalled the fight with George Foreman when he was the oldest heavyweight champion, correct?
Correct. George Foreman was world champion in his early 20s, 20 years prior to the night of when he knocked out Michael Moore to become the oldest fighter in the history of boxing at the age of 45 to become champion again. And George Foreman was losing that fight.
Oh, horribly. Yeah. He was. I remember that. I remember that fight very well at MGM. Yeah. And he looked horrible for the first nine rounds of that fight. And then the 10th round with the right hand crushed him. And it almost seems like Foreman, I thought afterwards, and you tell me, Foreman was sort of measuring him up throughout that fight, even though he was getting pounded,
yeah.
But he was still sort of measuring the kid, Michael Moore,
right.
And then...
Yeah, it was amazing. It was a punch heard around the world. Okay. I mean, the whole world was like, they were amazed at a man 45 years of age. But he's loved by everybody. The first time around of his career, he wasn't quite ready with the fans. People didn't like George Foreman at the beginning. He was kind of rude with everybody. But after he retired, became a minister for 10 years, come back out of retirement, and wins the heavyweight championship again. It was amazing.
Now, Sylvia, were you at all of these fights, supporting hubby?
No, I was home watching the fight.
Okay. And how was that? I'm just curious to know, as a wife, what goes through your mind?
Well, I think, we've been married 53 years, right? Or 54, something like that. And when we lived back east, we both used to work for the El Cajon Corporation, so he used to go to Atlantic City a lot, and I would go with him so that he would fall asleep coming back.
Wow.
So, over there, the fights are kind of different. And at times, there were some small little incidents that broke out, and, it would distract them. So when we moved here, I really didn't have time to, because I had to take care of my daughter, Cindy, so I really didn't have time to go to the fights. And just thinking that he might get distracted, I said, no, he's got enough on his plate. So I would watch it at home. I got a bit of you.
Wow. And you're actually teaching, you mentioned you teach others how to ref now.
Yes.
And also, how to become, you teach boxing classes?
I don't give boxing classes. I've been approached recently to start giving referee clinics online and teach referees. So I'm looking about doing something with the Faber Firm LLC. I started a Faber Firm Boxing Academy. And that's something that I think that's much needed because a lot of referees and judges need some training. And of course, it'll not only be for judge or referee. I want to get inspectors, ringside doctors, commissioners, all kinds of individuals in a boxing game to go under the Faber Firm, a boxing academy, and teach them the right way, to teach them the rules inside out.
Wow. Now, something, we're going to talk a little bit boxing. We're going to jump from boxing to what you're doing now in Las Vegas. This is really cool when I heard this. You guys have just opened up La Mansión. Did I say that correctly?
Yes, Mansión is a luxurious assisted living.
Okay. 14,000 square foot home.
18,000.
My goodness. Now, was this your home that you are changing. It's a 5-star luxury senior assisted living. Can you tell us more about that?
You know, I really don't want to take credit for this because I'm not the guy who was behind this whole thing. I mean, I'm like a referee. I want to be neutral and let the girls, let Renee Zamansky and Sylvia Cortez, let them talk about it because they're the ones that have been involved with this project a lot more than me. They have more better answers than I do. But if a fight breaks out, I'm there.
When Renee Zamansky joins us, tell us more about your role with this Lamancian, and tell us more. Lamancian. See, she says it's so much more elegant than I do. Tell us more about this, and kind of just give us, if you can, our listeners, what to expect.
Sure. So it Lamancian is a private 18,000 square foot estate that's been custom built for assisted living on 5 acres in a residential area with gated access only. As high-end as we could possibly get it, with all the amenities that you would see in a large 100-plus unit commercial assisted living. We provide all the services that you would see in a larger community, and we have extra amenities. So the things that we're missing in the larger communities, we made sure we included them in our smaller boutique-style assisted mm-hmm. living.
And there are 12 suites?
There are 12 suites.
Okay.
So it's very exclusive. We have 12 suites, but we have the capacity to have 16 residents. So we can accommodate a husband and wife in some of our larger suites.
Now, Sylvia, I know that you had your flair on this property, right?
Yes, this is my baby.
Tell us more about how you got involved. I'm sure you had a little, your advice on decor with this property because it is so high-end luxury. Tell us more about that.
Well, first of all, I want to correct you. It's not open yet.
Okay.
It will be open. We are assuming next month, a month after. You know, you always have those little glitches
mm-hmm.
with constructions. Anyway, this project started, the idea started like 5 years ago with my daughter, Cindy, who's lived with me as a result of a car accident. So Cindy was telling to me, Ma, when you guys pass, I'm going to sell this property.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, you have to wait for us to die. So I told her, at that time, we lived in the properties 15 years. So I says, you know, I really want to downsize. I mean, at that point, you know, as you get older, the less you have, the better you feel.
Absolutely.
So that's where the whole thing started. So we started looking. We obviously had to move out of the property, which we did. We bought another house, a smaller house nearby, and did whatever adjustment I had to make for Cindy. And then we started the project 2 years ago. So it's been busy doing this, doing that, getting some, we had to wait some issues with the sprinkler system. But we're moving along now, and things are getting done. So hopefully we should be pretty soon. One of the things also is that, which is good in the sense that now that we're coming out and telling everybody what we're doing, we can start pre-leasing. So people can actually, you know, start looking, hey, this is the one that I want, and, you know, do whatever it is, and, you know, we already have theirs reserved, because it is only 12 suites.
How, if somebody's interested, I know you said we can start pre-leasing, how can we find more information on this?
Oh, we go to our website.
Okay.
LaMansiónLV.com.
Wonderful.
And as far as the phone number is 702-428-4232.
Awesome. Now, will you have any boxing photos? is that like calming or?
You know, some of the seniors sometimes they get kind of cranky, and the fight may break up. And that's
right.
Why they're keeping me on the side, just in case they need a referee.
I love it.
But I tell you that one of the things is that we're self-funded, and this is something that's to us is very special, especially to my daughters. And I was they've all been in the medical field to some level or another, and I had the honor of being a board member for the Nevada State Nursing Board. I was appointed by two governors, and I did 2.5 terms as a board member. And so to me, that's a very special area when it comes to caring for seniors and caring and nursing. We know we have the best, but we got Renee on board with our executive director. We know we're getting one of the best ones out there. And my family, again, like I said, the girls have everything to do for us, getting the right people in place. And then the hiring, with Renee and Sylvia. They did the hire for the right people to have in place, the employees, the aides are going to be working. They're going to be very, very well taken care of. We're a loving family. We like to make sure that the seniors that live there will live a nice, comfortable life with a lot of attention and care.
Thank you so much for coming in and joining us and telling us more about this amazing property. It's going to be gorgeous. I've seen the photos.
Yeah.
They're beautiful. Congratulations. I wish you all the best on opening. I'm sure those 12 suites will go very quickly.
Yeah.
Right?
I'm trying to get one for myself.
Oh, very nice, very nice.
They're sitting on the roof, but they'll put me down in the basement someplace.
Thank you. And I do want to ask you one other question, just as on a side note. You were in Rocky?
Yeah.
Did I get that right?
Yes, I played in a Rocky Balboa movie. I played myself, and I helped out Sylvester Aspy Joe. I wanted this movie to look authentic as possible, and I was able to help him. I hired 23 real boxing folks in for the movie, the cut man, the corner man, timekeepers, inspectors. It was a lot of fun. I got to do one with Eddie Murphy. I was with Eddie Murphy 2 weeks ago in L.A. We did a movie called I Spy, and I did one with Antonio Banderas, Rudy Harrelson, played to the bone.
Very cool.
So I've been kind of fortunate there with my boxing.
That's great. Thank you again so much. Wish you all the best on your project, and thanks for coming in.
Thank you so much.
All right. Stay tuned on Vegas Sports Girl. We'll see you in a few. Thanks so much, guys.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
This was great.
Yes, no, I got here in 80, I got here in 84, so I fell in love with the city with boxing. And then a little bit after you, and then so
okay?
I'm staying here.
This is beautiful.
Let me get a picture with you, Jim. Is that okay?
I could never think of going anywhere else.
For the past 12 years, after the cancer
therapy, thank you. Thank you again so much, you guys, for coming on.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Good work, guys.
All right. Oh, got the door? I don't want to hurt anyone right behind you.
Okay. This is a little
kind of thing. Are you guys good on the way out? You know, perfect. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful afternoon.
Thank you.
Bye. Tanja, email that photo.
I
took one of the Brock. Then I was like, I don't know if this helps because you have that.
Interesting. I was laughing at almost people.
Yes.
Yeah, it's all right.
Well, then when she wasn't talking in my mind, I was like,
we don't have much time, right? I don't have anything major slotted right now to discuss.
We will have about seven and a half.
Let's think. What else is going on right now? You can talk some Aviators if you want a little bit. I don't even mention the long homestand. I love the ballpark. I've been
Let's
out there now.
Okay. I have stuff for that. You know, anyways.
You know baseball.
No, not necessarily. I just. Oh, unless you meant.
Oh, my.
Yeah, that's. No, that's always.
That's it. You.
Yeah, that's why I use this one instead of this one. They're really great. Anyway, yeah, you'll have basically like a little over 7 minutes from now.
So we can fill 7.
Yeah.
I know you can.
I gotta turn that one up though.
Yes.
Okay. And let me know when you're ready.
I'm ready. Come on, Ron. Stomp your feet.
You.
We will rock you.
Queen.
Love it. Love Queen. I haven't seen Queen in concert. Have you?
Well, you know, Brian May's still performing, so you can go out and see him. Obviously, Freddie Mercury was 91, I believe, when he passed. So it's not the same. Adam Levine ain't Freddie Mercury. Bless him. I know
right,
he tries,
right.
but still,
nobody's
Freddie Mercury. Nobody's Freddie Mercury.
You're a rocker, though.
I love rock music. It's yes.
Did you have long hair? I have to picture that.
I play the guitar, too. So
oh, my goodness.
You get a long hair and a guitar in my hand, and there you go. And
why do I see that, Ron?
I grew up in L.A., so I was going to concerts all the time because that was a great time. I'm biased, but in this late 60s or 70s was a great time for music. I mean, this music that still
oh,
is it stood the test of time. I'm going to sound like Grandpa Ron when I say I'm not sure how much music today will stand the test of time that we'll be listening to 20 years from
right.
now.
Right, that is true.
I'm going to say very little of it because
yep.
it's all the same.
You're so right.
There's nothing that stands apart, and
nothing.
It's become corporate to the point that it has to have certain elements to the music to that ruin it, that make it very predictable. That being said, okay, go ahead. The exception was the early 90s. You had a handful of bands come out. Is this a music show now? I'm turning it into a music
sorry.
Show.
I'm
no,
sorry.
I'm fine with that.
Are you
no
doing any good photos?
Oh, I was just saying, I'm scouring the internet here.
Yeah, you won't find me with long hair.
I can't find long hair, but I will say,
no,
you've aged pretty well.
You will not find long hair of me. I've got some at home, and I haven't put them online. But in the early 90s, you had Stone Temple Pilots, Pearl Jam, Red Hot Chili Peppers, Soundgarden, you know, those bands that came up. And when I first heard them, I said, okay, this is music
mm-hmm.
that I'm going to listen to 20 years from now, and I'm still listening to that stuff almost 30 years from then. Believe it or not, it's been that long. But so anyway, we've had some times that have been great for music and times that are down times. I think this is a downtime, and I don't know what brings it. I don't know what brings it out of it. I don't know what brings it up. And
we need just some really cool key artists that stand out. Right now, everything is everything is the same. I feel like everything is the same. There's no originality. That's just my opinion.
And if you can't sing, you can fix that.
Right.
You can
absolutely.
Fix that with auto-tune.
Right.
Yeah, and it sounds horrible.
You can dance
Kanye.
Or vice versa.
But yeah.
I wish I would have known that because I was always a dancer cheerleader and I can never carry a tune. But if I knew that we could fix that, I could lip sync very well.
You could do that.
And dance.
Yes.
So, aviator news. I know.
Aviators,
before we go,
yes.
We've got to touch upon our baseball team.
No, it's. I got to tell you, I love the ballpark out there. It's everything that we thought it would be and then some. And it's just been fun to go out there, watch baseball in downtown Summerlin. And check it out. They've had sellouts, I believe, in almost every game. I know their first 12 games were all sellouts. I think this homestand is continuing to be a sellout. So they're out there. They're in the midst of a 12-game homestand right now. And it's just fun to go out there. And well, here's what I like. Besides the baseball.
And the pool.
And the pool and the food, you get a sense of community out there. Because
mm-hmm.
you can hang out. You'll see a dozen people that you know. And that'll be fun. And So we haven't had that place where we could get together as a community. You could argue the Knights have that, but that's a little more expensive price to get there.
A lot
price,
more expensive.
A lot more.
A lot
yes,
more.
Thank you.
Yes.
A lot more expensive.
But
price.
I love them, and they're so
worth
every penny.
Oh no, I do too.
Penny. Yes.
I do too.
Yeah,
yeah,
but
yes,
it's true.
It's not,
right.
But this is more grassroots. This is
yep.
more just folks out there hanging out for $15 a ticket. So it's much lower price point. And it meets that, what was something we haven't had here in town, really, is a place where we can hang out, meet, say hi at a low price, and have
that's
a hot
true.
Dog.
You know what's crazy? People think when you don't live in Vegas, they're not, and they don't know the layout of our city, that there is not a lot of community. I think now, people used to come here from New York, and I remember they used to ask me, you mean, do people go to school and
no.
church on the Strip? And
no.
I'm thinking, have you been to Vegas?
No.
Now we've got community everywhere.
We don't even have grocery stores. We don't have grocery stores. We don't have gas stations.
I know,
we don't have
crazy.
No, we don't have parks.
It's all education.
None
it's all
of those
educating.
Things.
But we've got such a great city. Like, you're right, as far as community and ballparks and ice next to the ballpark. And it's really neat to see the kind of the transition, the growth of Las Vegas, and the potential. Especially now, I think we're going to attract a lot more tourists coming here that want to see football games that are maybe we never got here, obviously, before. Like the Patriots fans. I know you don't like the Patriots. The Patriots, the Carolina, whatever it is.
No, I like them to come here and spend money and lose their money and leave it here in town. Sure.
We love people here to spend money.
So, no, you're exactly right. When the Raiders come here, then, I mean, this time next year, we're going to be talking about it'll be more, it'll be on the fast track because it will be the Raiders are here. They will be practicing out in the Henderson facility this time next year. The NFL draft will have been held here
so
in Las Vegas.
So
there's, and we'll be talking about that first season in the new stadium. So all of that, we'll blink our eyes. It'll be a year from now. We'll be having this conversation. But I do love the idea that people can come in from out of town, which they will. A lot of them will come here and have fun and watch football here and leave their money here, and that's part of what we do here in this city that works.
That's awesome. We love Vegas. And I love Ari. This is like so fun. You cannot say this is not a TV show because he's doing the whole 1 minute, 30 second, and I love that.
Oh,
he
they can
on
see
track.
It.
I know it. So, anyhow, thank you again, Ron. It's always a pleasure.
Tanya, always, it's my pleasure. Glad to be here and glad to have had a fun show and see with Joey
fun.
Cortez again to see him was great.
Thank you to Finley Volvo and the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Check us out on VegasSportsGirl.com and also the social media. You'll find us on Vegas Sports Girl. Share us and like us. And we will be back here next Tuesday, 4 p.m. Looking forward to it. And have a fabulous week.
Cool.